Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick in the Philippines. Well, I just want to say this. I've been doing lots of teaching about the end times, and the Lord gives me lots of wisdom about the end times. I know I mentioned this in a video before, but the Lord has just given me more and more wisdom on this. Let me begin. The time of Jacob's trouble is another name for the tribulation period, and that's the time that the whole focus is going to be about God bringing a judgment on sin and bringing to conclusion sin, and the Lord to bring Israel to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. That's going to be the 70th week of Daniel, the tribulation period, a seven-year period that begins when the Antichrist, the prince of the people who will come, the prince of the people who destroyed the temple. Okay, so that's the Roman military destroyed the temple. And some people say, well, the ones who actually did it from other parts of the Roman Empire, that's true. The Roman Empire covered, a huge area. But it doesn't matter. The point is that someone who is a descendant from the Roman Empire, who will be the Antichrist, he will confirm a covenant with many for 7 years, a season of 7 years. That Shabuah there, King James, it says for a week, but the Shabuah there is the same to us as a decade. When you say a decade, a period of 10, we're talking about, everybody knows you're talking about 10 years. And that is a period of 7 years. And there's also many ways to cross-reference that. In the book of Revelation, it talks about two different periods of 1,260 days. Now, in the Bible, a prophetic year is 360 years, not 365. So that's how we get that. It's all divided down. And so there's the first half of the tribulation, and then the second half of what is also known as the Great Tribulation. Okay? And the thing that I'm trying to do is talk about some things that the Lord has shown me about Israel versus the church. But I just need to continue, I guess, with about the tribulation period. The tribulation period will begin with the signing of the peace treaty, not at the rapture. The rapture has, there's no signs for the rapture, and the rapture has no impact, immediate impact, on the timing of the Lord's second coming. The rapture happens, and then, after how many days, or moments, or weeks, or 5 minutes, we don't know, just pretty soon, they'll make that, confirm that seven-year treaty. And when that seven-year peace treaty is confirmed, the man who does that is the Antichrist, and that is the countdown to the Lord's return, when that treaty is signed. Now, when that treaty is signed, it's not going to be, the focus of that treaty will be dividing the land of Israel. It's written in two or three different books in the Old Testament, one of them being Joel. God judges the nations in the valley of Jehoshaphat for dividing his land. The Bible says in Zechariah, slipping my mind right now, I believe it's 12 and 14. You can see about the tribulation period. It says that I will make Jerusalem, will become a cup of trembling for all of those who try to deal with it, and a stumbling block. And it's also talking about there in the last days, in the end times. So the end times is all about what is going on right now. What do you think 9/11 was about? Besides the fact that, lots of people believe that it was, an inside thing, a false flag to bring about, World War III, the Illuminati plan to have the Muslims and the Christians fighting and all that, the devil's plan. But, even if that's true or not true, in the mind of those who did it, in the mind of those Muslim jihadists, it's all about Israel. They want to make Jerusalem their capital. As soon as the Muslim Brotherhood started taking over Egypt, the first thing they want to do is march on Jerusalem. And just as the Bible said, whereas the Quran says that, Mecca is the number one spot in Islam, and then Medina is number two. And Jerusalem is never even mentioned in the Quran. In their other book, written by the followers of Muhammad, the Hadith, the sayings of Muhammad, they claim that when he died, he rode a horse or whatever, and, in the middle of the night, and then he went to the Temple Mount, and then he went up, ascended into heaven from the Temple Mount or whatever. So that's why they want to do it. But in the Quran, there's no mention about it, nothing really about Jerusalem at all. So anyway, just to fulfill the end times, Jerusalem is the stumbling block to the whole world. That's what this is all about. All the stuff going on in the Middle East and all that all surrounds Israel. They hate Israel. Everybody hates Israel. But the Christians, the born-again serious born-again evangelical Christians. Everybody else hates Israel and wants to kill them. They've been trying to do it. You know, people know about Hitler. They don't know that in 1492 in Spain, same year that Christopher Columbus, who was an undercover Jew, sailed under the Knights Templar flag to allegedly discover the New World, which was already discovered by Eric the Red and Leif Erikson and them, you know, 400 or 500 years before that. You know, the Vikings had already been to North America. At least that's what we know about. At that time in Spain, they actually marched the Jews out into the ocean until they drowned. And they were forced to wear a yellow star like what Hitler did. Lots of countries did that. So what Hitler did was nothing new. The word ghetto, when I was in the army, I toured lots of places. I was stationed in Germany for 7 years. And I toured all over Europe, a lot of places. Thank the Lord I had the opportunity at that time. And one place I went to was Venice. And when I was in Venice, there is the original ghetto there. The word ghetto is an Italian word, and the word ghetto came about for the Jewish neighborhood. And it was overcrowded, jammed into that neighborhood. This was 400 or 500 years ago. And they were jammed into that ghetto, and they were, you know, at night, they had to be back on that island. They had a curfew and all that. During the day, maybe they were tradesmen or whatever. They were allowed to go out, and they made jewelry and all that. And but at night, they had to be back on that island there in Venice. And that's where the original word ghetto comes from. The people use today was the Jewish community. So the Jews have been persecuted since, especially since the time they rejected Christ, and even before that they were rejected because the devil tried to, you know, to stop the Messiah from coming. He tried to crush the seed of the woman before the Messiah could come. And then after they rejected the Messiah, you know what it says in Deuteronomy: they were cursed in the city and cursed in the country. They were cursed going in, they were cursed coming out, because they had broken the law. God sent the Messiah, and they rejected him. And so that's what I want to tell you about. The tribulation period is about that. It's not about us. It's not about the church. I've made videos about that. The tribulation is not about you or the church. It's about Israel and about God dealing with his evil world, okay, and those sinner evil Gentiles, okay, who, you know, who are not saved and will never get saved. They're going to take the mark. But what I wanted to give you is some types on that the Lord's been showing me. And it's always, you know, Jesus said those who are last to be first and those are first to be last. The church is going to be first to enter the kingdom of heaven at the rapture. Last will be Israel when the Lord returns. They will mourn for the one they pierced. It's from Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10. They will mourn for the one they pierced. And they will receive him, you know, as the firstborn son. And there's so many types and shadows of that. Something that I made a video about this before, you know, Isaac was born, was second. He was a child of promise, like the church, type of the church. Esau, type of Israel, type of the law, as it even tells us in the New Testament. I believe it's in Galatians. Paul says that, you know, the Hagar, the bondservant, and her son, Ishmael, is a type of the law, the children of Israel. They're, and then the church, Isaac is a type of the church, born, and you know, the child of promise. And then we see it again. We see the pattern again. We see, you know, Jacob, you know, is the second born, you know, and then Esau is the firstborn. And then we see that, you know, just tonight while I was praying, the Lord was adding to that, to me tonight on that, you know, that Jacob was the promise. He was the second one, like the church, the second born. The Lord was just telling me tonight, look, it says that Esau was a man of the field, and he was red and ruddy. You know, red is like Adam, means red earth man, like red dirt. Like in North Carolina, we have red clay. So I guess God, maybe he made Adam in North Carolina before he shipped him to the Garden of Eden, because it said after he made him, you know, he placed him in the Garden of Eden. And it's a joke. So Esau was, that's why they called him Edom, because of red. He was a red, like red colored skin. And he was a man of the field. And then it says that Jacob dwelt amongst the tents. And then tonight while I was praying, I mean, the Lord just spoke to me. He just dropped a nugget on me and said, look, the church is the spiritual manifestation, which I already knew this, but I never thought about it in relation to Jacob and Esau. The church is the spiritual manifestation of God. And our place is to dwell in the tents of his, you know, and of his presence, to dwell in the secret place. Our job is to offer sacrifices with our lips and praise, not in works, but offer our body as a living sacrifice, acceptable and pleasing unto God. Where in Israel they offered animals as a sacrifice. And Israel is the carnal. As the Bible says, there's another Bible verse that says, first the cardinal, then the spiritual. Adam was the cardinal. And in the same text where that is, where Paul's talking about the Adam is the, you know, the natural, earthly, carnal man who was born perfect but sin. And then Jesus is the second Adam. And I believe that's in 2 Corinthians. Jesus was born, you know, is spiritual. He's the second Adam. He's the spiritual Adam. Adam was the flesh. And then Jesus is the second Adam, the spiritual. So the same is true with the church and the nation of Israel. So it's the same thing with Esau and Jacob, is what the Lord was telling me tonight. Jacob dwelt amongst the tents. He was a smooth man. So like the church, clean, dwelling amongst the tents in the spiritual way. We're God's spiritual children, okay? Then his natural seed on earth, the natural seed of Abraham, that's Esau, you know, earthly, earth dwellers. Red, earth man, dirt, made from the dirt. But we, it's our spirit. It's not our flesh because we're Gentiles. It's not our flesh, but our spirit that's been born again. We're part of Christ. We're like Jacob. We're, you know, we're the spiritual children of God through Jesus Christ. Not the old covenant, but the new covenant. Okay. Then something else the Lord told me today that I never thought about. I believe it's in Romans chapter 9 through 11 where Paul talks about that Israel is blinded for our sake. They've been blinded. And then the Lord was just showing me again tonight. You're talking about Esau and Jacob. Isaac blessed Jacob because he was tricked by his wife. She tricked him and got, you know, Jacob to put this lambskin on his arms and all that in the clothes of his brother. And she prepared the food and he went in there and he stole his brother's blessing. Because Esau had despised his birthright, just like Israel despised and rejected their birthright and rejected the Messiah. Esau rejected his birthright for a bowl of soup. Then later on, Jacob supplanted, which what Jacob means, a hill grabber or supplanter. He supplanted his brother Esau and got his birthright. But why did Isaac not know who it was? Because he was blinded. He was blinded to see, you know, who he was blessing. And so Israel is also partially blinded to where they could not see Jesus. And they don't still can't see that we're blessed. The church is blessed. God says that the Bible says that God blesses the church to provoke Israel to jealousy. So now when the new wine is, the Lord had just given me a revelation the other day, and I just made a video about the Lord, you know, taking the new wine out of the mouth. That's from Joel chapter 1. The new wine out of the mouth of Israel. You know, the new wine being the New Testament, being the Holy Spirit, being the church. When the church is removed, you know, the blessings of Israel right now, brothers and sisters, and all you American bashers, I don't care what you think. There's lots of evil in America. I'm talking about American Christianity. America was raised up for two purposes that I know of. One was to bring Christianity to the world and the gospel, and, you know, we're still the number one printers of Bibles and all that kind of stuff. America and missionaries and all that. That's America. There's people who keep bashing America and making comments when I talk about America. You go ahead. But I'm talking about the history of America is Christianity. And we protected the Jews. There's more Jews in America and just until like last year or 2 years ago, there were more Jews in America than in Israel. Just now, in the last year or two, the amount of Jews in Israel has surpassed the amount of Jews in the United States. And that's another sign that it's time for the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. Okay, it's the end of the Gentile age, a.k.a. the rapture, a.k.a. the beginning of the tribulation, Jacob's trouble, 70th week of Daniel, tribulation period. Okay, these are all signs of that and crossroads that we're crossing into. And there is a new age, the tribulation period, 7 years where Satan's going to rule and reign through the Antichrist. And then, of course, the Lord Jesus Christ will return for the new age, the dawning of the millennial reign of Christ at his second coming, the end of the 7 year tribulation. Anyway, United States also, like I said, has protected Israel. And we've been protecting Israel. And so the Christians in America and probably, you know, less or so in other countries, but 99% in the United States, Israel owes, on the natural side, God is the one that's been doing it, all right? But in the natural, Israel owes its modern existence to the United States. Even though, you know, the British had the Balfour Document and all that, and the British Mandate and all that. But the first country to recognize Israel was President Truman. Okay, he recognized Israel immediately. We supported them. Even Nixon, who was not a Christian, who was kind of an evil man when he was a child. If you ever seen something called Against All Odds on Christian television, you can watch, maybe you can watch it on YouTube. Richard Nixon, as an example, when he was a child, his mother was a Quaker. And she had told him when he was a little kid, she read him stories out of the Bible, even though he was like a, you know, an agnostic or whatever when he was grown or whatever. A bad man, a drunk. He was a drunk and a paranoid drunk. When Richard Nixon was a little kid, his mom read him stories in the Bible about the children of Israel and all that, coming out of Egypt and all those things. And she told him one day, she gave him a prophecy and didn't even know it. She's a Quaker. She said, one day when you're grown, you're going to be an important person, Richard. And if you have a chance to help the nation of Israel, you do it. Now, she told him that when there was no nation of Israel, okay? Israel didn't happen until 1948. Richard Nixon was already a grown man and in the Senate, or getting into the Senate that year, 1948 maybe. You know, he was born like 1917, whatever, 1915, so I'm way back there. So long before Israel became a nation. His mom told him that. She gave him a prophetic word. Now, Richard Nixon told this himself. And Henry Kissinger, his Secretary of Defense, who was is a Jew, supposedly, he did not want to help Golda Meir. That's the Prime Minister of Israel. And Henry Kissinger was dead set against it. And he's even supposed to be a Jew. And as a matter of fact, just side note, when I lived in Germany the first time, I lived in Fürth, and I lived on Gustavstrasse, Gustav Street, Adolf Gustav Street. And that I lived in the Jewish ghetto there in Fürth, former Jewish ghetto before World War II, and I lived on the street that that Henry Kissinger was born on and was raised on. And so at that time, I read his biography, his autobiography. So that's been a long time ago. I can't remember what all it said. I know he was a sergeant in World War II and all this, and he did some translating there in Germany in World War II. But I read his autobiography because I lived on the same street he did, and that's when I was a backslider. I didn't know anything about him. I didn't know about the Illuminati and all that at that time. But anyway, Nixon, you know, Golda Meir called him at 3 o'clock in the morning, you know, and then she asked for his help to support Israel during the Yom Kippur War, 1973. And Richard Nixon was also facing Watergate, and so he needed all the political support he could get, and the political support was against him helping Israel. And it was not in his political interest to help Israel. And everybody was against it. But the Lord reminded him, here he was, not even saved. Just like King Nebuchadnezzar and all these other people who God used. God can use, spoke through a donkey. God spoke to him and reminded him of the words his mama told him when he was a little kid, like 3 years old, 4 or 5 years old. And reminded him, and in his spirit, he was led by the Lord to tell Golda Meir, we'll back you. And it was the point, just like in the point of World War III, because the Russians were trying to get involved. And, you know, Nixon lent them all the support they needed, and the Russians backed down because they were going to look at invading Israel. And it would have been the end of Israel. But, of course, God wasn't going to let it happen. But who did God use? He used the United States again and again and again and again. That's why we've been blessed, brothers and sisters, because of our support for the nation of Israel. That's why we were raised up. And so it's time for us to hand the baton, the church, to hand the baton back to where we got the baton from. We got the baton from those apostles. Paul, all of those guys were Jewish. Okay? The oracles of God were written all by Jewish people. Except for Luke. But Luke wrote down what the Jewish people told him. You know, the witnesses. He wrote down what the witnesses told him. So it's time for us to hand the baton back to our Israeli root. As the Bible says, the root of our blessings is Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And his natural seed, the sons of Israel. It's time for us to hand back the baton to the sons of Israel. And it's time for us to depart out of this world. And that's the Bible verse that the Lord gave me while I was praying. When the Lord Jesus, the Lord has just prompted me a little bit more on that same text, brothers and sisters. And maybe John chapter 13, when Jesus was ready to depart out of this world, it says. Just before that, I think it's some Greeks came to Andrew, and then Andrew told his brother, and then he told, I guess that's Peter or whatever. Anyway, one of the disciples told Jesus, hey, there's some Greeks here who want to see you, some Gentiles. And then Jesus was deeply troubled, you know, and he started saying, Father, glorify your name. And a voice came from heaven, I've glorified it, I've glorified it again. And then the Bible goes on to say that, you know, as Jesus was about to depart out of this world, you know, he loved his own even until the end. He loved the disciples even until he departed out of the world. And the Lord just prompted that verse in my spirit for us, the church. You know, and that's when the baton was, this wasn't my intention to say this when I started the video. I want to talk about the comparison between Israel and the church, and about Esau and Isaac and all of that, and Jacob. But the Lord has prompted me to say this, so it's straight from the Holy Spirit, as the Lord keeps doing to me on my videos. Thank the Lord for that, for all who would watch it, and myself included. That the baton, when Jesus was troubled in his spirit, because it was not time for the Gentiles yet, after the Lord had been resurrected, until after Pentecost, then it would be time for the Gentiles to begin, after Israel had rejected their Messiah, to the Jew first and also to the Greek, the Bible says. So the Jews had to reject the Messiah first, have him crucified, then reject the message of Pentecost and start prosecuting and persecuting the apostles. After they began to persecute and kill the apostles, they had killed James, the brother of John. He's the first apostle to die, and John was the last. His brother John was the last apostle to die. They were ran out of Jerusalem, and then the gospel started going to the Gentiles at Antioch. So it's time for reverse, brothers and sisters. The Israelites are showing up and asking and inquiring, you know, why is these followers of Jesus blessed? Maybe he is the Messiah. You know, there's a remnant of Israelites. And so it's time. It's a reversal of what happened when the Lord departed out of this world. It's time for us to depart out of this world. It's time for us to pass the baton back to the nation of Israel, brothers and sisters, to the 144,000 witnesses. For those who do not believe in the rapture, there's tons of reasons why there will be a rapture. And one of them is, why does God need 144,000 Israelite witnesses if the church is still on earth? Answer is, we won't be here. Those 144,000 are inquiring right now. They're seeking, but have not got saved yet. They're just at the verge of getting saved. The moment we leave is the moment they'll be coming into salvation. And they're knocking at the door, inquiring to see the Lord. And so, just like when the Greeks tried to see Jesus, and he wouldn't see them, and he was troubled because he was ready to depart out of the world. It was at the time of the Last Supper. So, brothers and sisters, it's time for the Last Supper for us, and time for us to go to the marriage supper of the Lamb.